For the last couple of months, I have been working on and off on a chat app spot for work, which has now becoming a chat app spot or the side as a side project because work thinks it's close enough to done that I don't have development time for it all anymore. So I am part of a team of sysadmins at Penn Medicine. We actually have six Linux admins in our group and two Windows admins. Cheyenne is not here, but he's our DB admin. If anybody knows Cheyenne Pike, who comes to these out every so often. And the major problem with being a sysadmin is, things go wrong. Things go wrong all the time. You want to know when things go wrong, hopefully before your users do. And so we have monitoring systems. And the best way to hang on to your monitoring system is in the place where you spend 80% of your time already, which is IRC or Jabber. If you are actually enjoying your job, that is.
Or even if you're not.
Or even if you're not, yes. This slide is more for the folks that are going to be at Foscon at the end of the month. I think everybody here knows what a horrible thing DevOps is already. But we love our bots. So this can run in IRC, but unless you're running your own IRC server, I wouldn't do it. It's not for Freenode. Because aside from exposing all your dirty laundry when a server goes down or you're being DDoSed, if you want to be able to send commands back to your chatbot, you need a chat system that authenticates for you. So we have Jabber that's run by the University of Pennsylvania. We're going to start having to run our own, though, because they're moving away from Jabber towards Slack. And we're either following the herd or spinning our own.
Have you considered looking at Rocket Chat instead?
I have not considered Rocket Chat. We have started mumblings about Mattermost.
I have Mattermost at work. I recommend Rocket Chat.
Okay, good to know.
But Mattermost is better than Slack.
Yeah.
So I'm saying de facto.
Okay.
What's wrong with Slack?
So, as I said, we have Jabber.
That's for beer later.
We also had Nagios to monitor our systems, and we've since upgraded that to Edzinga 2. We used to have a chatbot that somebody had written long, long ago. It no longer works.
Was it written in Perl?
How'd you guess? Well, I mean, nothing wrong with having been written in Perl,
yes, there is.
But but I wasn't going to upgrade it. So, for those who don't know how this switch was forced upon us, basically monetization, Nagios is an old thing, almost 20 years old. Edzinga is not exactly a hot new thing, but for the sake of religion and open source and actually being able to work with it without tearing our teeth out, it was time to move to Edzinga. And fortunately, Edzinga has built into it, but it is an optional feature that you should turn on immediately. REST API that listens on your server, and you can connect to it through localhost or remotely if you let your firewall do that.
What's REST?
REST is an acronym that I forget what it stands for.
Representational State Transfer.
Representational State Transfer. It basically lets you make custom HTTP requests with, get, put, post, and then it returns values based on your request.
It's a fancy way of saying the first time you look at a website, it's going to send you everything. And then after that, it'll cache parts of it and only update the parts that change, is the high-level summary of it.
Okay.
Yeah, it's also, it's also a way of getting information, over a browser if, you don't want a custom GUI, or if, you're having to run things through firewalls. But even though this is on HTTPS, it doesn't run on 8443, so who cares? but really, the Python and Perl and Ruby and a couple of other options can talk to any REST server. Python uses the requests library that you would use for any other web page. Yeah.
Is it XML or JSON for the REST API?
It returns JSON.
Excellent.
Yes. Which easily is parsed into Python dictionaries.
So Nagios is going away, right? Like, is that what
Nagios is not quite going away, but people are going away from Nagios.
I think it was Debian 9 were reading for a stretch. They're no longer supporting Nagios.
Not surprised.
So they're going. It was in Singular or something.
Yeah, because basically Nagios core has been stagnant, and all of their new features and bug fixes have gone into Nagios Enterprise, which is a commercial bolt-on.
Okay.
That's what spawned, several forks, out of which Nzinga became the most viable.
Okay.
And then with Nzinga 2, they decided that they no longer wanted any of the old Nagios code. They rewrote it from the ground up in C. They made it a bit faster. But since they use a REST API that returns JSON, you can just parse it with anything else you want. So for the actual chatbot, I decided to go with a concoction called Urbot, which is written in Python, which means I can actually understand most of the code, and has multiple front ends so that you can have it listening in a Slack channel or in an IRC channel or in Jabber or a couple of other protocols. And this is what the simplest chatbot command looks like in your Python code. This @bot command, for those who don't know, is a Python decorator. It's a shorthand way of wrapping what follows in a function or an object. So I don't have to go through and say, turn this into, this 3 lines of code into 8 lines of code to describe redundantly all of the ways that it talks to the bot. So if somebody types bang hello in the chat, then the bot will say hello world.
Another way to put that is, of decorators, like an implicit vo- void function pointer where you can just call it the function that you want to call it right afterwards and it just does stuff. And here, verse in C.
So, after a couple of months of smacking my head around and learning how to talk to Super in Python and, you know, putting everything together so that when Itsinga reported a server was down, it said in the chat, "The server's down." Server's up. Server's back up. Rachel says, "God damn it." Rachel says, "God damn it." you can have in Itsinga, for example, a comment like "God damn it," but you can also acknowledge an event and say, Windows team is looking at this, or 3401 data center is down, ignore everything for 2 hours. Which happened to us
recently.
Last month. Yes. A transformer blew. The transformer took longer to fix than the data center's AUPS and the backup generators could hold out. Yes.
Sounds like Baltimore.
Do you guys at work, sysadmins, do you use IRC?
We use Jabber, XMPP. I actually, my desktop at work, I've got the lovely dual monitor set up. Some folks have four. I won't name names, but he's a DB admin, and he occasionally comes to this event. I've got my email and my browser and 17 shell windows, and then over here there's IRC with you clowns and Lopsa, and then down here there's Jabber with my team.
I think Jabber's based on the same protocol as AOL and Messenger was.
Huh?
I think AOL and Messenger.
No.
AIM. Yeah,
XMPP.
Yeah.
Ron, I was going to say, if you want to play around with a really neat project, OpenFile is a open source XMPP implementation.
AIM is Oscar. That's a whole different protocol. AIM and ICQ are the same protocol.
Oh, no.
That's Oscar.
Jabber is XMPP.
Yeah.
Right.
It's referred to as Jabber, but XMPP is the actual RFC.
Right.
One of the nice things about XMPP and the Pigeon messenger chat applet is the fact that it can be extended to include encryption.
Yep. Yes.
So there are times when we need to, have a lockdown chat, and we can do that, which is one of the other reasons that we're looking at not even going near Slack. Frankenstein says, "What?" Except for the fact that apparently there are library problems with Airbot itself, and I need to refactor the way that I'm calling things. Yes.
Two questions. First, CentOS, you said you were using Python before. Are you using software collections to do that then? Or how did you get Python 3.4 on there? Did you build it?
Python 3.4 is actually the standard package on CentOS 7 with, with the usual, backported
right,
security things.
They're like bleeding edge, aren't they?
Uh-huh.
No, they have 3.5 now, but
3.6.
Yeah.
No, I have 3.6. I have 3.6 on my CentOS, but
okay.
you just need a different repo.
Yeah.
All right,
I'll have some questions then afterwards.
Yeah.
So that,
the other question
but,
I have is
3.6
but,
is the latest.
But Debian 9 and
no,
iOS. 1.2 after 16.10, certainly 17.04, I think 16.10 as well, are running Python 3.5, and something broke.
So, have you try to contain some of the stuff with using virtual EMD and passing the environment around?
I am doing that somewhat. You know, I run the production bot in a virtual ENV, and I am doing that in the VM I've created at home for development.
Mm-hmm.
But Airbot actually recommends running in virtual ENV regardless.
Okay.
They say, because it's a pretty large, significant user space thing, and it's easier than Docker.
Have you thought about systemd install?
And the idea.
Here's something. Ask it in. Yes, and when I do, I pick up a heavy piece of wood.
So when you say VM, you mean an actual VM.
I consider climbing up there to hit you with it. Yes, I'm sorry.
So when you say a VM, you mean an actual VM. You're running like in a CentOS VM is what you're saying.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. I take my cute little Ubuntu box at home and I spin up a Cent7 VM. And I virtual end inside of that.
Gotcha.
Okay. Yeah.
Now the virtual end is necessary mostly because of your have a different version of Python, or is it the different libraries and everything, or is it all those things?
It's mostly for the libraries and to be able to have something that runs cleanly as user Airbot. Basically, if you have a virtual end set up, you can give it a small manifest and say,
I want
these modules.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And, no matter what happens on the rest of the system, it's clean in that, so it's more replicable.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if that's the particular reason why the Airbot developers recommend running it in a virtual end, but it's convenient enough for to work with.
But that's going to add another step every time you kick the thing off, right? Because you got to set up the virtual end, and then
no. Once you've set up the virtual end in your user environment, you've basically got your own bin tree inside that environment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So one liner.
So you CD into the root of the virtual end.
Yeah.
And then you kick off.
You run the activate script. It's a Bourne shell, and they also have a C shell script, and you just run it, and then it just sets your pants and everything for you.
Right. No. But what I'm thinking is, if there's some other Python that you want to run that needs a different virtual EMV, it's going to have to go to a different one.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Correct.
Right. Yeah. You got to.
In fact, run it. You got to pick which virtual EMV you're going to use.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's. That's part of the benefit of it. You could use it also in, a test environment for porting, and run symlinks to your code and see, does it run in the 2.7 virtual end? Does it run in the 3.4 virtual end? Does it run in the 3.6 virtual end?
Oh, so this is not, so it's not a virtual machine, it's just a virtual environment.
Yeah, it's just
virtual
a
environment.
Oh, okay.
That's supported within Python.
I
think almost every distribution calls it the Python virtual end package.
Three comes with its own own VM library in the standard library. So for 3, you don't necessarily have to install it. It's just that you don't have to install like virtual end separately. It's just that one's a little bit more fully featured. But the built-in VM in Python 3 works just fine. That's what I use.
One of the reasons why, I was like, okay, I will finally take this good advice, was because I have usually tested my code inside IPython, but the way Airbot uses self and super, and, then IPython, aka Jupyter Notebook, and that we're really getting in the way of each other.
Yeah.
That, so yeah, I'm looking for people to jump in and weigh in on this. So I have one bug report from the first person to tell me that it didn't work in Debian 9, and I confirmed that. And as part of the refactoring process and, you know, making things a bit more modular and object-oriented, I am, you know, hoping to fix that. But right now I've got, you know, a couple of hundred lines of Python all in one script, and it's time to clean that up. Yeah.
Is everyone at work happy that you have this, so you don't have to worry about the old crap breaking and not being there anymore? Like,
except for one of the Windows admins, yes.
Well, everyone counts, even if they are a Windows admin.
Yeah, everyone's capable of being an admin. It depends. There are people who say, this is telling me something is broken, I'd better look at it. And then there are others who say, this is telling me something is broken, kill it with fire. Okay. Actually, I think Dagored was even put up the bit from Nagios.
The said operator?
Huh?
The said operator about Nagios?
Yes.
I'm pulling it up right now.
Yeah. I will.
Basically, it came down something about Nagios does not equal fake news.
Yes. All right, and you guys already know this, but people at FOSCON will not until they see this.
Cool.
So I can show you a little bit of the code itself here. By the way, that whole thing was done in Markdown.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Wow.
I was going to ask about that.
Yeah.
The effects and everything. That's
all
locked down.
Yeah. Git pitch is, you know, I knew I didn't want to bother with an actual presentation thingy again this time. So I decided to just write everything in Markdown and spent a few hours looking for ways to do it. And this way I didn't actually have to download and install Reveal.js. What they will do is, if you put a file in your project called PitchMe, they will automatically pull that and convert it into slides for you.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, so the slides are also here. Yeah.
They just don't look like slides.
So, well,
that's
kind
point.
Of, but that's it, exactly it. The
source
these,
code for slides.
These odd little pluses, that's where the vertical transitions came from. Git pitch. So, as you can see, it pulls in a lot of libraries. That's one reason why I want to factor things out. And it's kind of bashy and defensive, but it's supposed to be defensive. This is where the magic sort of happens.
Can you blow a font up?
Yeah. One thing that I do not like about the Itzinga APIs, the JSON it returns has a different format for each event type.
exact quote for you, by the way.
Ah.
I
well, forward it to my Twitter, and I'll pull
okay,
it up.
I'll do that.
That had unfortunately led me to...
Is there something other than open paren that you can break a Python line on?
Not really. You can use a backslash, but that's it.
Deprecated.
You have to break it inside some sort of structure or with a backslash. You can go line by line with your dictionaries or a list of lists.
Some of the lines get pretty long. And
they do, and that's partly because I'm also wordy.
I'm not talking about yours. I'm just talking in the general.
Oh no, I know.
They can tend to get pretty long.
Yeah. Well, that,
if there's nothing you can do about it, then there's nothing you can do about it.
Python ain't Perl.
Exactly.
Widescreen monitors.
Well, we're not on punch cards anymore, so we don't actually have to do everything in 80 columns.
Well, I would disagree, but...
Unless you're in COBOL.
I just shared that tweet with you, by the way.
All right, let's have a look.
80 columns? No, 80 columns. A luxury to have 80 columns.
Right, that's actually 72.
72,
yeah.
I just ordered you.
That's not right.
Oh, there it is. It was there.
Yeah.
Boy.
At SAD server, I also recommend following SAD operator while you're at it.
Yes. Would normally have had a demo, but MariaDB is being a pain in the ass. You do need MariaDB for the Itzinga web GUI. You need some sort of DB. It could be Postgres.
What's the GUI used? What do you use the GUI for?
The GUI is basically to give you a quick overview of your uptime. It's also another means, or still our primary means at work, of basically putting in acknowledgments and scheduling downtime until I've got all the bot commands fully fleshed out. Yeah.
Has someone come across and go, maybe we should replace this with something for ManageEngine at all?
No. What's ManageEngine?
I think you would prefer to stay ignorant on that question.
Okay.
In a nutshell, it runs on Windows.
It sounded like something that ran on Windows.
And it's in India.
Yeah. And
that's
what I think it is. He's using the SNMP trash for everything too.
Oh, good God. One of the nice things about Itzinga is it's trying to get away from the, offer a path to get away from the vulnerabilities that are available in NRPA. So SNMP is going way the wrong direction. And that only took a half an hour? Huh, I'm gonna have to pad this out.
No. Hey, that means more beer.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions?
Just to go back to the GUI you were talking about, that's part of Is that part of?
I can bring that up.
Yeah.
It's single web two. It's called. There's also, they still have the Itsinga Classic GUI, which looks more like Nagios, and there is one particular feature in it that I deeply miss, which is basically expansion of all your check commands in, you know, on the web page. But this is not what I meant to do. View image. This is basically what this Itsinga Web 2 GUI looks like. It'll give you, you know, your host is up, but it's got a problem. The overview is good looking. In general, you can also put, you know, much nicer graphene dashboards. This is what the old, no, that's the installer. Sorry. Okay, here's one. Where you can actually view a grid of hosts and services that, you know, tell you what states they're in. Red is critical, yellow is warning.
What does Itsinga Enterprise give you that regular Itsinga doesn't?
There is no Itsinga Enterprise.
Oh, okay.
Although, there is an Itsinga Tower, which is probably, you know, that is just a more capable GUI, but it doesn't change anything about Itsinga itself.
And it also probably gives you a number to call and complain to somebody?
Yes, it does.
And how my customer mind?
That.
Any more questions on the code or Itsinga?
Yeah.
How close is Itsinga's configuration to Nagios? Are they drop in?
Itsinga 1 was a drop in. Itsinga 2 has a different object style. It takes some adjustment and tweaking, but what's nice about it is that you can actually apply rules programmatically. Where if you have, you can put, for example, a host directly into a host group, or if you're naming your servers like cattle, you can have, you know, put web in the host name, and Itsinga will automatically add that to your web servers group if it finds a match. You can also filter them on IP address range, or you know, there are multiple filters that you can apply to run your check rules. Was that a hand up all, or was that
no.
Just a okay.
Description was.
Yeah, it's not a quick transition, but once it's over with, it's painless. It is easier to work with.
The Debian stretch Debian 9 release notes suggest that they're migrating from Nagios to Asinga automatically, and they claim to bring your config over.
If they are going from Nagios to Asinga 1, then that is perfectly easy to go from Nagios or Asinga 1 to Asinga 2. There are conversion scripts that are provided by Asinga or available on GitHub that got us about 90% of the way there, and then you know the rest had to be hand massaged.
That's not bad.
Mm. Yeah, how hard is it to add additional like modules or additional like anything like, to your Python bot from Asinga?
From Asinga, or
like from like a, if you see something that's coming from the REST API.
Mm-hmm.
I guess another question is, how do you get something that you identify in Asinga to come through the REST API? Is that automatic, or is that is there additional steps you need to do to link that?
Yeah. Okay. The bot has an event stream. That tells you the results of its checks. Now, I don't recommend pulling down every check result. I would filter that out of the request, but every state change, every comment, you know, uptime, downtime, those show up in the event stream. And that is that gets parsed. I'll show you exactly where it's done here. Config read. Post checking. Okay, this is just where I set up the Asinga itself, the connection itself. Merging the events here. This is where it connects to the stream. So right here where you're saying stream equals true, that is a requests parameter that says keep the connection open until it's dropped.
Oh, so this goes back to like the socket, actual socket connection itself, so it figures out whether or not it's going to hold it or if it's just a quick burst, that kind of stuff.
Correct. Ooh. Yeah, so if you're sending, well, you're also getting the queue from right here. You're telling Asinga that you want an event stream, and then you're telling requests to make sure you keep the connection open to listen for it.
Got it.
So then the bot runs an IRC channel and holds that one connection open to the application part of
the thing. Correct. It's not even the bot itself, it's the plugin. AirBot itself is, you know, a modular creature that, you know, makes the connections to the chatbot, but then you can add plugins to it that will, you know, pull down lolcats or stock information or, you know, chat ops.
So is this how is the stream coming in that's non-blocking then? Or is that just magic that's behind the scenes that you don't know what between like AirBot and
That is in the requests library and in the Asinga API itself. As you know, it doesn't block it doesn't have to block IO. It just, you know, unlike Nagios, it's capable of running a lot more threads, doing more simultaneous checks, and it can also have a couple of different output streams in the API.
My question is actually more of a raw Python question, is because normally whenever you have a socket stream open like that, it's more of you open up a socket in Python, and unless you're using something like Twisted, as long as you're listening, you're blocking. Plain and simple.
Okay.
I didn't know, so I'm assuming, seeing how you don't feel, or you didn't seem like you understood that, I'm assuming there's some magic going on with FBOT that's doing that for you.
There are a lot of things doing that.
It's, that's actually in the URL group 3 connections library.
Okay, so, all right.
I understand what does it appear. I don't understand how it does.
No, that's fine. And that's actually, that's awesome because the URL 2 library would block. So
okay.
That's how MPy had that issue. So
I see.
Yeah. Cool.
Do you want me to diagram show you how I sync up with like the flow? Do you want me to?
I don't, but they should have some edit sync.org.
Okay. Cool. What Easter egg do your bot at work?
None yet.
Not yet?
None yet.
Okay.
Easter eggs?
In other words, you'll say something like Big Dango, right? And maybe his picture.
There's a little Python Easter egg. If you open up the command prompt and just type in import this, there's a nice little Easter egg in Python for that, which is surprisingly very helpful.
Yeah.
And it took me years to finally understand that everything that is in that import this when it comes out this like wacky little poem thing.
It is mostly the philosophy of Python.
And it's dead on. And you're thinking this is
great.
Right,
one way to do it, you will do it, not other way.
No. But no more than three.
What is your favorite color?
Another fun one is if you ever tried it in Python, do from underscore underscore future underscore underscore import braces.
Oh God, yes. That's awesome.
Oh.
Okay, I'll do it for y'all.
Oh.
It works in both Python 2 and 3.
Bigger font.
But only import anti-gravity works in 2.
That's a shame.
Yes. So just Python.
From
a future. You forgot the two underscores after future.
Of course.
It's okay. Notice it says syntax error in red there, not a chance.
So I guess.
While you're there, just to import this so everyone can see what we're
I guess
about.
Begin
so
end is right out.
It is literally the Zen of Python.
It's awesome.
If
it's
when
all
I'm
going to
do my Python
introductory
course, actually, I'm going to have everyone start with this. So,
right, you're going to have them import this. We can.
Yeah. It's like
what
happens world, but
if
like
you
better
from this.
Yeah.
Import Zen.
Where's the white space should be syntactic?
Correct.
Huh?
It should say white space should be syntactic.
It says it right in the first line. Don't you see it?
Beautiful
is better
than
ugly. Mr. One Liner.
Who needs all those semicolons?
And those curly braces.
Oh, and it also says again a little bit further down. It says readability counts.
Yeah.
Walt.
Yeah.
Walt.
I'd like to be able to press the percent key on top of a squiggle and get to the end of the squiggle.
And you can indent the entire squiggle, and then your editor knows what it all means.
If someone wants to see 5 minutes of sheer awesome, it's called Destroy All Software, is the presentation. What is WAT?
Okay.
Oh, yes.
One
oh, yeah, that one.
Another time, another place. So, any more questions or more beer?
More beer.
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 Yeah.
Yeah.